Hey folks, this is Abel James, and thanks so much for joining us on the Fat Burning Man Show, where we talk about real food and real results. Are you training for short-term results or for longevity? How can we train to not just avoid the hit, but to actually take the hit? And most importantly, why deadlift when you can just get butt implants? Today, I'm honored to be here with Juliet and Kelly Starrett, co-founders of The Ready State and co-authors of the new book, Built to Move. After decades of working with pro athletes, Olympians, and Navy SEALs, mobility pioneers Kelly and Juliet Starrett wrote their new book to focus on long-term physical well-being for the rest of us mere mortals. As you'll hear on today's show, by rethinking your environment and working in easy, simple, and enjoyable mobility exercises, we can train to be more durable now as well as later in life. But before we get there, can you believe this podcast has been going for more than 11 years? Please sign up for our newsletter at fatburningman.com. Just hit reply to that email, and I read as much feedback there as I possibly can. You don't always find me on social media these days for various reasons, but you can always get in touch through our newsletter as well as find over 500 episodes of this free show spanning more than a decade, all at fatburningman.com. And when you sign up for the newsletter over at fatburningman.com, I'll send you a few goodies like our wild quick start guide, some recipes for delicious cookies that won't torpedo your fat loss results, and much, much more. So one more time, you can support us by going to fatburningman.com, signing up for the newsletter. And if you like this show, please remember to hit subscribe, share it with a friend. All of those little actions really help us a lot. And if you're feeling extra generous, don't forget to leave us a quick review. I read all of them and really appreciate it. All right, on to this show with some of my heroes, Juliet and Kelly Starrett. This is a fun one. We're chatting about why deadlifts are better than butt implants, despite what Instagram might tell you these days, why 5 to 10 minutes of daily mobility training compounds into huge wins over time, how the whitewater rapids that flipped Kelly's raft eventually led to true love, why walking is prescribed to elite warfighters, how to make stretching a fun pair bonding or family activity, why it's important to balance heavy lifts with mobility training, how to set up your living and working environment for longevity, and tons more. Let's go hang out with Juliet and Kelly. Welcome back, folks. Today, I'm honored to be here with Juliet and Kelly Starrett, co-founders of The Ready State and co-authors of the new book, Built to Move. Juliet is an entrepreneur, attorney, and podcaster. As a professional whitewater paddler, Juliet won 3 world championships and 5 national titles. And returning to the show as well is our friend, Dr. Kelly Starrett, New York Times bestselling author and physical therapist who consults with athletes and coaches from the NFL, NBA, NHL, and MLB, as well as the U.S. Olympic team, elite Army, Navy, Air Force, Marines, Coast Guard, and much more. Kelly is also the proud owner of what might just be the most spectacular natty calves in the entire world. Welcome to the show to both of you.
Oh my God, welcome to the show. You have no idea how happy Kelly is about that. Oh,
only because I feel seen.
Yeah, finally. Yeah,
finally.
This is why I'm such a fan of you in the show.
Well, as we talked about before we started recording, it's been a minute. I remember your work well from Mobility Wad back in the day, and it's been keeping all of us honest, whether we like it or not, for a long time, because I was thinking about, like, what's the best way to think of your new book, having read a bunch of the other ones in the past? And it's embarrassing for me to go through a lot of the exercises and mobility drills and all the rest of it. It always has been. But last night, my wife Allison and I really got into it, and it was incredible, rolling out, getting to all the spots that I really know that I needed to get at, but I've had problems with hips and knees and backs over the years as the years tick by. And so I just want to start with a tip of the hat and say that you've been doing incredible work for such a long time, and we really need it out there. All of us do. And thank you for writing a book for athletes and non-athletes alike. I think that's really unique and special right now.
Thank you so much. And I know this is your podcast, but I'd really be curious to know which one of the tests that you struggled with, if any, or did you get a 10 out of 10?
10 out of 10, well, come on.
Are you in the 10 out of 10 club?
It depends on which test you're talking about. But I found that doing the cross-legged up and down was pretty easy on one side. But when I switched my legs, my balance was way off. And my wife, Allison, who exercises and does sports a lot less than I do. She's very athletic as well. But she just aced it, no problem, both ways. And so that's especially humbling when you can start to see the value in staying limber, doing mobility over just those heavy lifts all the time. Or I've always been a big runner, and I could be a lot better about not being stiff in the wrong places, you know, especially my hips, the IT band have been issues for a while. So we got that big old basket of tools out and foam rollers and the Theragun and all the rest of it. And I slept so much better. I feel pretty great today, I'm going to be honest with you.
I love it. This is really the goal of this book, was to create some objective benchmarks for people, and allows this book or some of these behaviors to, you can just sort of use it as a third party validation. Hey, I think I'm doing great. I've got some nutrition stuff that's working for me, I think. And I'm engaged in some kind of exercise thing I love. Let me see how well that's allowing me to maintain my shapes, keep myself honest in these physical behaviors. And so oftentimes, you know, when Juliet and I are like, look, you're a runner, we don't really care how much you deadlift. I mean, you know, theoretically it's a lot, of course, but you know, ultimately what we want people to do is say, hey, look, even though you may be engaged in or have an activity you love, it doesn't mean that you should lose track of your native range of motion, that you have to wholesale throw out all of these innate skills, because you might want to, I don't know, do something else one day. Or turns out, you know, that stiffness in your hip is going to ultimately impact how well your spine functions and ultimately how your brain interprets how your spine functions. Maybe that's part of the reason you have low back pain. So by establishing these benchmarks, these are not touchy-feely benchmarks. These are science-based, researched, and the sort of second half is these native ranges of motion that every physician, every orthopedic surgeon says you should have, but we don't even think about. Well, I'm strong and I breathe hard today, I'm good to go. Hold up for a second.
The other thing I want to say is we love hearing that you are doing the tests and doing them with your wife. Yeah. I mean, that was one of our goals with this book. These universal vital signs that are actually fun to do. And it's fun to bring in your family and your friends and your neighbors and your parents and actually go through these tests and, you know, even get competitive about it if that's what you're into. But it's really fun to hear that, you know, your instinct was to do it and do it with your family because that was part of the goal.
Yeah. And it's wonderful. And humbling, like I said, because when you do it with other people, you have something to compare yourself to, right? Because it's just like even putting my legs up or one leg at a time up to 90 degrees and using the strap or whatever. One side for me was fine. The other side was a mess. And, you know, my hips are starting to lift up. And Allison's like, what's the problem? She's just doing the 90s on both sides and dancing around. And so I think having the ability to compare and contrast that sort of thing is really, really helpful. And it does make it a lot more entertaining. We were talking about that last night as well. But to stick on the kind of pair bonding and doing all of this together piece, you basically saved Kelly's life at the beginning of this book, right? Maybe you could share that story a bit to show why it's important to focus on some of these fundamentals.
Well, I'm going to punt that over to Kelly because he is he's got to be the storyteller of this. I had actually never heard the term meet cute story until this book came out, and yeah, a bunch of people said, oh, your meet cute story is so cute. But yeah, Kelly, take it away. Let's hear it a little bit.
Here it is in a nutshell, is that the allegory that we use is that you need a PFD and a life jacket. And one of the things that was happening is that Juliet, we were both at the World Championships down in Chile. It's class 5. It's super gnarly. It's a week long or multiple events. Teams from all over the world are there. It's legit. Some of the best paddlers on the planet are here and converging and trying to live and not die in these big rivers. And the boats are tiny and there's chaos. People go out on backboards and get helicopter. It's gnarly. Well, the boys, we keep our life jackets very loose, because we want to move and rotate and not be encumbered. But the problem is, if you've ever been in a loose life jacket, when you're in the water, it actually floats above your head and doesn't really serve you at all. The women are smart and practical, and they basically made their PFDs part of their skin, so that when they ended up flipping in the class 5, there's no funny business. Now they can be about rescue. So I'm loosening it. We're flirting. I'm loosening Juliet's PFD. She's tightening mine. We're like, we're flirting. And then we go and run this rapid, and it's the boys' team, girls' team. We're just sort of doing a, you know, test. And the women pulled over to scout this class five rapid. We did not, because we had scouted it from like a half mile up.
And yeah, like from a dirt road a half mile up.
I mean, if you, it's like watching football in the NFL and being like, I could have made that move. You know, meanwhile, down on the course, like everyone is 6 foot seven and 280 pounds is going to kill you. But from up in the stands, it all looks very reasonable. So we were up in the stands. We scouted this thing. Very soon we were offline, and we were horrifically offline. And we ended up flipping above the one feature you don't want to swim. So we swam above the thing you don't want to swim in that normally eats you. So we swam into the thing. I got pushed to the bottom of the river. I'm bouncing. I'm tightening up my life jacket. I'm being crushed. Our $400 carbon paddles are floating away. Our raft is upside down. And Juliet's team paddled up and started plucking us out of the river. So, you know, ultimately what I told her was, yes, you probably saved my life, but also I had to bribe my friends to flip in that moment so that I could set up this like M. Night Shyamalan movie. The scheme is the sting. I'm like, okay, guys, we're going to flip here. The women will come save me. I'll get Juliet to pay attention to me for the first time. Anyway, that's the story. And that was I like to say that's the first time Juliet saved my life.
And important visual, just piece of imagery for everybody at that time. Kelly probably weighed 40 pounds less than he currently does. And his hair, he had hair and it was dyed white blonde. Just to set up the visual.
That does change
the
story.
Just to set up the visual. Yeah.
I was probably 187. That's
187
right.
Yeah. With hair and it was dyed white blonde. But I thought he was so cute.
In my 20s.
Thought he was so cute.
Yeah, there we go.
It worked. I'm glad your plan worked, Kelly. But I want to make sure that there are so many things I want to get into. But I want to start with this question of why some people fall apart and others don't. Like, just talking about hips and running, because that's kind of my personal example. I've seen a lot of people as the years go by, especially as we approach and a lot of my peers middle age, who need new hips. You know, like they've had to stop sports altogether, even at the age of 30 or something like that. And so there is a danger here of kind of ignoring the problem until it becomes too big. So perhaps you could start with some of the easy things for people to get into at the beginning to rewild the body. And you could talk about some of the other issues that you raise in the book. But for me anyways, I know that I should be doing a lot of these things, but I don't because it's so painful. So maybe you could offer a few words of encouragement to get some more people to do it.
Let's take it this way. Let's start with the assumption that I'm going to wear my body out. So that is an assumption that we've told people, and it's flat out wrong. Look, we have a really old cat. He doesn't look like he did when he was a young cat. So aging happens, right? That's okay. If I took a picture of your skin now as compared to when you were 17, it's going to look different. But your skin still works. It does all the things. And the body is designed to last 100 years with a lot of pretty hard miles on it. It really is. Mm-hmm. So we have this type one error where we're like, hey, I ran a bunch. I had to get new hips. That's not how it works. How it works is that we're all expressions of our environment, and we may have engaged in behaviors and activities and practices that didn't allow our body to handle the kinds of volume and loading. Look, trauma is real. That happens to people, and that can set off a whole host of, you know, a jet ski goes over the waterfall in a big wave and lands on your hip. You can get traumatic arthritis from that. That's different than what we're talking about here. But one of the things that we have never done for people, especially athletes, is said, here's what you should be able to do with your body. And there's going to be a session cost involved with the kinds of training. So a session cost in sport is we do a hard training or a hard game. The next day, your ability to sort of generate the same force, have the same range of motion, the same output, is the degradation is the session cost, the cost of the session or the day before, the thing we did the day before. So through exercise and nutrition and adaptation and recovery, we're trying to minimize that session cost. We're always trying to say who can adapt the best to the stimulus. But what ends up happening oftentimes is we don't take that in the moment idea, that day to day, and sort of apply it to, well, I've been a runner for 20 years and that's my jam. Well, what is the session cost of sitting in front of a computer or being a runner or not eating fruits and vegetables or not sleeping or having disordered sleep for a decade? Mm-hmm. And ultimately what we see is that those degradations, lack of a range of motion, plus these other things end up sort of impacting our bodies And our bodies are so tolerant until they're not. And I think what ends up happening is that it's difficult for humans to be thinking on a really sort of long scale, because what we do today doesn't really seem to impact what's going on. So how can we think differently about this and say that the game and the physical practice I engage in today helps me minimize the session cost so I can continue to do the things I want forever?
And one of the things that we would like to encourage everyone listening to this who has a body and wants to keep using it is to apply what I would call the 401k principle to their own body. Mm. You know, we commonly save money, and that's a form of delayed gratification, so we know that we can retire. You know, nobody listening to this is just going to run a marathon tomorrow without saying, okay, I'm going to run a marathon in 8 weeks, and here are the things I'm going to do leading up to that. And so what we're trying to do, and one of our sort of goals in writing this book was to encourage people to say, hey, why don't you go ahead and set 5, 10, 25, 50 year, depending how old you are, movement goals. What do you want to be able to do with your body in 5, 10, 25 years? And then actually work backwards and start to think about the things you need to be doing in terms of the care and feeding of your body now, so that you can make sure that you can do those things later. Because you are right, you know, oftentimes in our own business, in the ready state, we find that people don't find us until they're already injured. And then, you know, and then of course they become evangelists of taking care of your body, doing the care and feeding, right? But you know,
only when they can't do the thing they want to do.
But only when they can't, then when they can no longer do the thing they want to do. So you know, I would encourage everybody listening to this to actually, you know, get out a pen and a piece of paper and write down what it is you want to be able to do with your body and work backwards in terms of trying to think about what do you need to do to be able to continue to do that. And the second thing is, you know, we thought so long and hard in this book of how can we encourage people to change behavior? And you know, you've done exactly the right thing, which is sort of having the tools right there at the ready in your TV room so that they're easy access. And so we've really thought about how we can create these environments where people can get these little snacks of input into their body so that it doesn't have to feel like one more list, one more thing to do. And it does not need to be done in an hour class. It can be, people can make a lot of input with 5-10 minutes a day that really compounds over time.
And I was going to ask you both, and I'm sure you have more answers to this. How do you find your blind spot? Because that's the whole, you know, idea of a blind spot. It's impossible to find on your own. But going through some of those tests in this book, it made it pretty obvious to me what some of the problems were. Because I've broken my foot in the past. I broke my toe last year. And I could see how this is starting to cascade. Even though it seems like I'm mostly healed, it's not symmetrical. And my movement isn't as symmetrical as it should be. What are some other ways, or maybe you could just talk about some of the tests in this book as well, but what are some of the ways that we can identify those asymmetries and those cascading problems before they're major, major problems that prevent us from playing our sports?
Well, we divided this book into sort of two parts. You know, part of the book, the vital signs and benchmarks have to do with movement and range of motion. And then the other part of the book is more about what we call sort of behavioral vital signs, behavioral metrics like sleep, breathing, food. And of course, in our mind, all of these things are intimately connected. And, you know, you even just said, as you led up the prior question, that you actually spent some time doing some of the tests in this book and working on your mobility. And then you found that you slept really well last night.
Yeah.
And that then today you felt better and were ready to go.
I felt better last night too. I didn't want to do any of this, but the times that I've done it, I feel better in the moment as well.
In the moment, and then you slept well, and then you know, showed up today ready to work and be your best self, right? And so we see all of these behaviors in this book as deeply interconnected. And I think I lost sight of your actual question. But
you know, one of the things that you said is, hey, sometimes it's not fun to do this stuff. And we agree. We really like, and you know, one of the things we're always looking at is where are you going to put this in? And what's the minimalist effective dose? How do we have this effective dose where it becomes like, oh my gosh, I'm going to go have to do a 3-hour yoga class on a Tuesday night. I'm exhausted. I just want to watch Mando. And instead, what we've got is this notion that, as Juliet said, these small inputs really start to aggregate over time. How many, if you ever have little children, do they love to brush their teeth? Or is that like a fight? You're like, all right, we're going to go and we're going to brush teeth. But ultimately all the adults brush their teeth. Why? Because we've been able to show adults that brushing your teeth and flossing is a net positive to your behavior. It ends up just being part of your system. And when we begin to think differently about our environments and we give people objective, clear measures, like the objective measure is, if I asked everyone on the planet, how long should you brush your teeth as a minimum? Everyone's like 2 minutes, right? Punk, right? Like everyone's heard that. What's good blood pressure? What's decent blood pressure? 120 over 80. Is that good? No. Is it bad? No. But it means that, hey, I need to start paying attention. And what we had realized, especially with this modern obsession with longevity and performance, is that there are very few true objectives. And it's what we see is that people, they eat a certain way because it gives us cachet or social standing or an identity. I'm a CrossFitter. But how do we actually measure that those things are working towards and inuring towards your benefit in terms of all of these sort of non-negotiables? And so ultimately, whatever you're doing, you should be able to drop right in, have these quick tests and say, oh, killing it. Or as you say, oh, I realize that I'm not showing myself this exposure to this thing. And now I've quickly found out that I'm like, oh, I'm behind or below, or it's more difficult. Now I can work on it a little bit and then forget about it.
Yeah. And, you know, just as an example for myself, the test that I struggle with the most is the squat test. And, you know, I had a really bad ankle sprain in high school. I've had some hip problems on my right side. And so, I have also experienced sort of a cascading loss of my range of motion on that side. And I am never going to have the ankle range of motion of Kelly. Like, he has what we call toddler joints. But I also have a really important piece of information in doing the squat test in this chapter, which is that, you know, I definitely am in the yellow, if not even in the red. And it's something that I need to make sure.
You're not red, baby. You're not red.
But, you know, it's an important piece of information that I have because I took an objective test. I know where I stand, and I know that that's something that I need to focus on. You know, one of the things that makes Kelly have a side head twitch is when people approach him and say, "Hey, Kelly, what's the one thing I should be doing? What's the one calves. Mobilization, right, calves?" You know, and of course, it's impossible for him to answer. But I think, you know, this book gives people some objective measures, and they can really discern for themselves what their blind spots are. And, you know, we think all of these things are important, but in every case, people are going to do better and worse on some of the tests and give them information about what they should focus on. Because I think that's the other thing is, you know, I think in this fitness business, we fire hose people with information and they kind of know they should be doing all these things, but people don't know how to prioritize what to choose. And so we're trying to say, okay, take these 10 tests and you're going to figure out really quickly what you need to prioritize in terms of the basics or benchmarks of your health.
And Juliet was just so everyone understands and can relate. Juliet was engaged in sports, rowing in high school, state champion, collegiate rower at Berkeley, then world champion in a paddle sport, and adventure queen, didn't have to have full range of motion in those ankles to be really successful. And so oftentimes what happens is that when people are confronted with, well, it's because I'm special or I'm a runner, we're different. And that really doesn't sort of pass the sniff test. Then when something happens down the road, you have less range of motion, tissues get crankety because your nutrition isn't great and your sleep isn't great. And now your range of motion and how you manage that isn't great. It's difficult to sort of pull at that Gordian knot and understand what's what, right? We're looking for like, no, I have a hammer. Show me exactly where to hit the engine so the engine turns back on. It's a little more complex than that. And that's why we've got to take a systems approach.
And you also mentioned in the book that there's no skill or quality that doesn't require practice if it's going to be maintained. And talk about humbling. So even if you are good at something today, you still might need to work on this and the
rest
of it.
But I squatted last week. I ran. Right? I ran 2 weeks ago. Didn't I? Am I done running? I ate vegetables a week. I mean,
we're not as gifted as we think we are, right?
Yeah, I mean, our view is: look, if you can do a full squat, feet straight, you know, have the most wonderful ankle dorsiflexion of all time, that's great, but it doesn't mean that exactly you should just put that in the closet and forget about it. It's just a position that you know you need to keep touching and make sure you still have access to it. And, you know, if you do have any injury or, you know, sort of catastrophe, you probably have to pay extra attention to it. So, you know, exactly. Nothing gets put away forever.
You know, we can say that your range of motion and those capacities are sort of like credit scores. And if you don't believe me, have a baby, don't sleep for a week, or a year, jump on a red eye, go run a marathon, and then we'll just see how your range of motion is. And you're going to realize that, wow, I am not moving very well. That's okay. We can buffer that, right? We can manage that. Let me tell you a story of one of our friends, Laura Phelps, who turns out to be one of the best powerlifters on the history of the powerlifting world. Laura was a level 10 gymnast as a kid before she found powerlifting. So very competent gymnast. And subsequently, she was able to hit positions and shapes in powerlifting that just allowed her to be very, very strong. I squatted with her once. I had my best squat ever. It was like 500 pounds, 525. I had like 125 pounds of chains on there. Louis was watching. She got in, tripled it on her way up to 800. Like she was, I was lifting with the women that day and was the weakest woman on the platform.
Wow.
But we became friends because she started having this pain in her knee and a friend connected us. And she thought that her career was over. Her hip and knee were bugging her. She was going to retire. And I was like, hang on, let's just see if we test a couple positions. And it turns out she had just gotten really stiff. And she was like, well, I never had to work on this because it was such a gift from being a gymnast. But all of a sudden, all this powerlifting made me stiff. All we did was give her a couple drills to restore her position. Bam, she went out and set a world record the next week. So she went from retiring to setting a world record simply by you saying, hey, I need to have just a little bit of input, even though it used to be gifted at that. And I think that's a sort of allegory for how most of us are. I have been great. I was always great. What the hell happened?
Yeah. How much are these things antagonistic to each other? Powerlifting versus being super mobile, for example, or being like a distance runner?
Well, I'll tell you, you know, what we want everyone to understand is that everything has a session cost, right? And it's actually a really useful way of understanding what our goals are. So what is your goal? Because, you know, what we hear on the internet is strength is never a weakness. You can never be too strong. I'm like, well, I don't know. If you're 230 pounds and you deadlift 700 and you don't run very, you can't extend your hip anymore, it really does affect your running.
Yeah. Right? Yeah. It's a lot of weight to move around.
What we can do is help people conceptualize that, hey, if we have movement minimums and benchmarks, what you can start to say is, hey, this is costing me the ability to have my hip in extension or running, and I need to pay attention to it, or maybe I'm doing so much of it that, you know, I see that its impact is on my sport. So ultimately, what we've told people is you can be great at everything, and that's not really true. What we, you know, you're gonna, you know, if you're really into running and we're super into cycling, it's very difficult to also become brutally strong and spend a whole bunch of time on the bike, or get a bunch of hypertrophy and then spend a bunch of time on the bike. So what's useful is to say, hey, if I'm doing a sport, right? And I'm not talking about, I'm middle-aged, I'm 50 years old this year. What's my goal? To be like, I just don't want to hurt and ride in my neighborhood. I want to ride with my friends and do, you know. But if I'm an athlete actually competing, then in season, the goal of all training is to make me a better runner, for example. And so if I'm getting slower because I'm doing a bunch of powerlifting, then I need to connect those dots and say, well, what is the minimum amount of squatting? What is an appropriate strength that I don't have to, you know, keep an eye on? And it was Pavel early on who said things like, hey, if you can do 1.5 times your body weight, like front squat or back squat, you're probably strong enough. 2 times your body weight deadlift, you're probably strong enough to do any sport on the planet. And maybe you need to start spending other time there. And we saw that even in some of the best lifters and coaches working with the throwing athletes. So they were like, look, it's really nice to put another kilo on the bench press, but what you need to do is actually go throw a little bit more. Yeah. So when we start to view this way and apply that fabric over all the things, hey, I'm really into vegetarianism, cool. Does that have an impact on me? I'm super into keto. Cool. Hey, there's no fiber. We're starting to see other issues. We can start to say, hey, the things I like to do, great, but maybe have an impact on my ultimate goal. And it's difficult to wrap our heads around if it's longevity. Easier to say, hey, this powerlifting thing is costing me my ability to run hills effectively.
Well, and I would just add that it, for professional athletes or elite athletes, there's always going to be a compromise. I mean, we are dear friends with Mark Bell, and you know, he was, you know, one of the strongest people on earth, but in order to do that, he had to weigh 300 pounds and he had so many physical compromises in order to be able to do that. And you know, now he's sort of, you know, rewired his entire body and is running a marathon, right? Because he the compromises that he had to make to be able to be one of the strongest people on earth, you know, didn't actually serve him trying to be like a, you know, middle-aged dad who wanted to move through his environment and be more physical. So I think all professional and serious elite athletes are always going to make some kind of compromise. But for the rest of us, I think it's all about trying to find a little bit more of that balance. You know, we want to be, you know, and also be able to continue to do the things we want to do. So we love to mountain bike. We also love to lift weights. And so we're always trying to strike this balance between how can we be strong enough so that, you know, we feel good and have as much muscle mass as we can, and also actually still be able to ride a bike uphill.
And I love how you folks talk about durability as well, not just trying to avoid the hit, but actually being able to take that hit. So maybe you can talk about that next.
Yeah, I mean, we really don't actually relate that much to the word longevity. We've really focused in on the word durability when it comes to our own goals for our bodies. And the reason we prefer that as a description is that we don't really actually care if we live to be 105 years old, especially not if the last 15 years of our life we're stuck, you know, in a skilled nursing facility in bed all day. Like, that's not, we're not interested in that. We want to be able to feel good in our bodies now, be able to move and have mental acuity as long as we possibly can. And then, you know, hopefully we just fall off cliff at some point, die in our sleep, like Kelly's grandpa did, you know, the ideal death, just, you know, you're alive and then you're not alive. But, you know, and also, you know, we've had our own, you know, health challenges, both of us. And so we take the view that it's sort of not if, but when, you know, everybody's going to have something that comes their way that's unexpected, whether it's an injury or disease or something. And, you know, obviously we can do our level best to prevent those things with all of these practices, but, you know, there's still going to be the unexpected that happens to a lot of people. And we want to prepare our bodies to be able to handle those things as well as possible. And so to us, that's durability.
Even if it's not trauma, maybe it's you have a family member who gets sick or a really stressful time in your job. You know, one of the things that we think about, for example, for folks that we work with is we're like, hey, let's look at drinking, for example. Like, Juliet and I are total fans of a really good margarita. And I have come to appreciate an old fashioned. But what ends up happening is that it really does impact my sleep. And then if I don't sleep very well and don't recover, man, my output for the next few days is actually diminished. I see it. I can't hit the watts. I can't lift as much.
But I mean, not just your athletic output, but also your sort of cognitive output, like how you show up at work and you're prepared for, you know, being creative and thoughtful. And
totally. So what I need to always not say is drinking is bad, but hey, when should I drink? Well, it turns out when I'm on vacation or we're celebrating and I don't have a big deadline the next day, I can see that drinking is a stressor and a chosen stressor, that I'm going to have a margarita because it's awesome and I want to be with my friends and that tastes great. And it's okay that I see this degradation instead of, man, this huge thing is happening in my life and I'm not engaged or don't have a plan to manage the amount of additional stress. So if I reach for that margarita when I'm hyper-stressed, overworked, underslept, what I'm going to do is add another stressor that's going to make me less able to cope. Now look, don't get me wrong, that's a valid coping strategy. I'm not trying to take that away from everyone. It just turns out it's not as effective at having a whole host of behaviors that integrate into allowing me to handle that stressor. And the alcohol as allegory then means, you know, what we see is that you could use that alcohol as poor nutrition, didn't move very much, didn't get any sunlight, didn't have any meaningful connections with my family and loved ones today. Those are all net stressors.
And you also talk, I want to make sure that we talk about this too, because the way that the internet and culture has changed the world of fitness as well has been very obvious if you're on Instagram, where it's just the world of butt implants. But Juliet, I've heard you talk about that. You have your own take on butt implants versus deadlifts. Maybe you could just riff a bit.
Well, I mean, I think I'll just start by saying that, you know, one of our motivators for writing this book was that we feel like we include ourselves in the we, you know, we have fire hosed people with information in the fitness business.
And $1 trillion industry.
It's a $1 trillion industry. And if you actually look at any metrics of how we're doing from a health standpoint as a society, it's not well. We're not doing well. You know, obesity rates are up, diabetes, ACL tears in kids, depression, loneliness, social isolation.
Substance abuse.
You know, if you just go down any metric that anyone cares about in terms of our, you know, sort of societal health, we're not doing well. And so, you know, we sort of tried to look inward a little bit and see how did we ourselves contribute to this mess and fire hose of information, and how could we redirect people back to what are really the most basic practices. We were actually on a podcast yesterday on KQED, and you know, a woman wrote in and said, hey, the practices in your book have actually been part of the Indian culture since, like, you know, BC, and you know, these basic things that we've been doing are what we've always been doing. They're just basics. And so I think what we want to do is bring people back to these fundamental basic practices that really move the lever the most in terms of our health and our well-being, and try to just sort of eliminate some of the confusion. And you know, my obsession with butt implants is that it's actually a thing. People are doing it, which blows my mind because surgery is gnarly.
Yeah.
And you know, in my view, there's—
Is it gnarlier than a flat butt?
I mean, you know, but there's also this amazing thing out there called deadlifting, which is really effective.
Yeah.
And doesn't require surgery. So I'm a big fan of deadlifting. There's, for some reason, there's some hate about deadlifting on the internet as not a great move. I totally disagree. I love deadlifting.
Those people don't ever lift anything up.
I think it's amazing. And I think it's like one of those movements that you know you can do until you're 90 years old, and we will definitely be doing, and is, I think, a much better approach than getting a butt implant.
Yeah, especially if you're talking about the long game, right? Because implants and tattoos, some of these things don't age as well as mobility drills.
So
I don't even think, you know, we know what a 20 years down the line butt implant looks like yet, right? You know, people are a human guinea pig.
Your ability to move through the environment doesn't have to change. That's really what, you know, if we define mobility, I think when we wrote Supple Leopard, we were like, it's about having your native range of motion that everyone agrees on and control of that range of motion, and then biomotor output. And really, like, okay, that's a very technical definition. A better idea of mobility is, can you access your body's shapes and positions and then use those shapes and positions to do whatever it is you want to do in the world? That is really the truth, right? Maintaining your movement choices, maintaining your movement sort of vocabulary. And you know, no point in your age does it say you can't have access to your hip flexion. It doesn't have to go away. Your ability to bend your knees doesn't change. Can you imagine if we just took that conversation out and we're like, yep, at some point your elbows just stop bending. And then good, I don't know how you eat, but your elbows just get super, like, that doesn't even happen. And one of the reasons it doesn't happen is that you use your elbows a ton every day to grab and manipulate the world and feed yourself. You just continue to use them. So what we're really trying to help people to do here is reconceptualize the fact that if you have a benchmark and you've been empowered with the idea that muscles and tissues are obedient dogs, and you don't have to give up your ability to move through the world, get up and down off the ground, lose your balance. Those things are all easily trainable and maintainable. And then lo and behold, you end up at 70 or 80 one day and you're like, I don't know, I've always been like this.
So one quick story about just being able to move is Kelly actually went on a ski trip in February to Japan, and they got to a hotel and learned that the hotel staff kind of started freaking out because their group needed one more room than the hotel staff had prepared for. And it turns out that they had plenty of rooms. They just didn't have a Western focused room for Kelly. And by Western, meaning the bed is high above the ground. There's a table with chairs. And what they had plenty of was a Japanese room where the bed is on the floor, the table's on the floor, even things like the thermostat is, you know, like, you know, 3 feet off the ground to sort of be approached like from a sitting or squatting position. So the entire room, including the bathroom, is situated around getting up and down on the floor and sitting on the floor. And, you know, if you look at cultures where, you know, sitting on the floor, or sleeping on the floor, or toileting on the ground is still a thing, you know, people don't have trouble getting up and down off the ground because they practice it every day. It's something that's built into their daily lives.
And we see decreased fall risks. We see fewer hip fat fractures. We see less lumbar disease. And it's not the magic that you slipped on a futon. It's what your body had to do to get up and down off the ground.
And, you know, and they're not, you know, in these cultures, people aren't going to like their get up and down off the ground class. it's just built into their daily life. These, you know, moving their body through full ranges of motion, it's just built into their life. And so, you know, that's one of the things we're trying to help people wrap their head around in this book, is that these things we're asking people to do and to practice can be built into your daily life. I mean, that's why we're such fans of the, you know, do some mobilization, soft tissue work, care and feeding of the body in front of the television, on the floor, in front of your couch at night, in 10-minute increments, because everyone's got 10 minutes. And, you know, again, back to the compounding interest philosophy, you can really do a lot of care and feeding of the body if you just think about your environment a little differently and then just do the thing that your body's supposed to do sometimes. You know, put your shoulders over your head sometimes, squat down, get up and down off the floor, you know, put your hip into extension. Some of these basic movements that in many cultures are just built into their daily lives.
I would just say that the number one reason people end up in nursing homes is they can't get up and down off the ground independently. And the number one reason people go to the ER is they've fallen. And falls are the number one reason. And it's interesting because getting up and down off the ground is like, whatever, you know, it's whatever. Like, you're a great runner. I'm a great athlete. Like, Juliet's a world champion. But, you know, what we want people to say is it's not the thing, it's the components of the thing. Right? And that we oftentimes fail to appreciate the impacts because we are so physical. One of the intentions of this book is that the people listening to this, you probably have some true blind spots. I guarantee it. You're not 10 out of 10. How do I know? Because we gave this book to a lot of our world champion friends and we're like, let us know what you think.
They're not 10 out of
10. They were like, I didn't eat any fruits and vegetables this week. I don't get enough protein. My sleep has been crap. I don't walk and decongest. So they had a whole bunch of things that, you know, we realized we could accelerate their athletic performance. We've chosen 10 features that we think are the hinges that open the biggest doors and make the base for any conversation we have with any professional team, any professional group, any athlete. We're like, you do these things, then we can actually get further with the training that we're doing. But simultaneously, everyone listening here, you're the person we need to go out and change the world, because you are looking at diet not just as body composition. You're looking at diet as a way of fueling, a way of health, of having healthy tissues, right? You have gotten the memo, if you're listening to this, that you probably need to breathe hard and lift a weight. But what we want to do with this book is create an easy way for you to become a super node and go reach out and transform your family. Because we know you have family members, we know you have people living in your household who do not identify with eating a certain way for performance or otherwise, do not identify with exercise, and they just don't like it or have never done it, don't have a practice for it, don't even have a rationale for why they should do it. And this is a place where we can say, hey, look, here are the benefits for you, we know, but also reach this out, and we want you to bring everyone along on your fitness journey.
Because let's be realistic, you're probably not going to give gift supple leopard to like your sister or your mom, right? I mean, you know, it, I think, was a transformative book for a certain niche of people, right?
Sure.
Who could really understand and could get technical and, you know, it's a work of art, of course, but it's not going to be the kind of book you can gift and hand
to
your neighbors
and friends.
It doesn't
tell you what to do day to day.
And yeah, and it's not prescriptive. And I'll be honest, it's not as fun. This book is way more fun.
Watch this. We've been married for 20 years. You're not wrong about that.
Oh, beautiful.
And watch this. Tell me more.
No, tell me more. That's like this. That's our number one piece of marital advice. And mostly for men, because I think often women need to verbally process more. And, you know, I don't mean to make broad gender generalizations, but you know, we learned that a long time ago, where one of our friends told Kelly, he's like, look, if your wife needs to process, your answer, even if what you want to do is run for the hills, your answer should always be, tell me more.
Tell me more.
I love that. Let me talk about this too, because I think it's important that people recognize that I'm sure you folks have been sent oodles of gimmicks, gadgets, all sorts of things.
Every single one of them.
And I certainly have as well. I'm sure not nearly as many of those things, but we've got baskets of useless things. Most of them are quite useless, or you don't need them. And in your book, you talk about the things that are exceptionally useful, like a lacrosse ball. And so it kind of takes the excuse away. We've had a lacrosse, I think, since Supple Leopard, maybe even before that, we've had a lacrosse ball in the passenger side of the vehicles that we drive around. And so whoever is sitting shoddy can be like working on the areas of their back while they're there for their long drives. And these other pieces of equipment that you're talking about aren't like installing a giant workout machine that costs $10,000 in your living room or something.
It doesn't scale.
Yeah, it doesn't scale. Right. I mean, yeah, we really have, like you had access to all the bells and whistles, and there are certainly things we've fallen in love with and a lot of things we've, you know, thrown directly into the dumpster. But I think that's another way in which we've sort of lost our way and made fitness and health inaccessible to so many people is that, you know, both from an expense and a relatability standpoint. I mean, those of us who are in this health and fitness niche, and this is what we like to talk about at the dinner table and do on the weekends, like this, it's all great. We can play around with the bells and whistles and it's fun. For us, for 98% of the people who, you know, just want to feel good in their body and be out of pain and be able to sort of do the basic things they want to do with their body, you know, they can't relate to those things and it's not accessible. And so we, you know, we really, again, wanted to, you know, bring it back to the basics about what's accessible, what can people actually do? How can we help people rethink their environments so that it's easy for them to do the things that they know they should do without having to call upon willpower and motivation? And so, yeah, so, you know, we love the occasional bell and whistle, but we don't think that that's really necessary to feel good in your body and be healthy.
It's more about building that practice, right? Of getting down on the floor and rolling it out or just taking the lacrosse ball and getting in there.
I think even we could go a step further and ask, when are you going to do that? You know, we created this idea that let's create range of motion standards. And those standards happen to be built on strength and conditioning principles because to press a barbell over your head or hold two dumbbells over your head requires full range of motion in your shoulders and control. So it was like we had a built-in program there. And ultimately, you know, what we realized then is that, hey, is it a good use of your time to do a bunch of foam rolling at the gym? Yeah, maybe if something hurts and you can't squat. And then you roll out your quad.
Yeah, trying to like get ready for a specific position.
Right, like I can't hit this position. Now I mobilize and then I can hit the position, right? That makes sense. But the rest of it, we wanted to get out of the gym. We were like, this, you're not doing enough of it. It's eating into your squat time and your skill time and your running time. So where are we going to put this? And what we found over the course of 15 years plus of doing this was that if we gave people the last 10 minutes of the day and said, hey, here, when you're watching TV, you might as well work on your soft tissue. 10 minutes, 20 minutes. We found that 10 minutes was a therapeutic minimum dose. 5 minutes on your left leg, 5 minutes on your right calf. And then you were like done, right? You could ask yourself what's tight, what didn't feel good, what feels stiff, what's tired, or nothing hurts. I go looking for, you know, blind spots. But ultimately in that 10 minutes, as you're saying, what we found was that, hey, we can also sit on the floor. And there's a perfect time to be able to have these net positive things. You did something clever by saying, well, hey, the car, I'm constrained. And we actually, when we travel, we take a hyper ice, you know, hyper volt percussion gun. And we keep it in the car because the person not driving is like, oh, I can massage my feet and I can do all these things because I'm stuck in the car. But if we ask people when and where you're going to do it, that really is the magic towards, hey, is this thing sticky and can we be consistent? Because we need you to be consistent before you're heroic, and consistency always trumps in all features.
You know, we have this thing in the book called the 24-hour duty cycle, but if, you know, if I could break it down, you know, we've realized in our own lives that people have sort of two times in their day where they have agency and control over their health. And that's in the morning before they go to work and when they get home from work in the evening and, you know, often right before bed, because if you have kids and you're making dinner and, you know, helping
with
homework,
a deadline.
You've got a deadline, whatever. So we found that these are sort of like the two critical times of the day where people can really, you know, make some positive input into their health. And, you know, we obviously have lots of ideas of things that you can make your workplace more, you know, movement friendly and, you know, get in some movement throughout the day. But, you know, the morning and the evening are really the times. And, you know, anyone listening to this, we would just challenge you to really rethink what those times of the day mean. I mean, we are huge fans of breakfast because it's actually something we can make at home. And we know that we can make sure that we can get some fruits and vegetables on board at that time.
And a little protein.
And a little protein. We have a 3-vegetable rule at dinner where we make sure we always have 3 different vegetables served at dinner. So we use those times when we're sort of outside and we, you know, we actually have control over our environment and of our, you know, of our time. That's where we've really figured out how to fit in all of these little small levers, small practices. Some people call them movement snacks. And these things are all apart from exercise. I mean, we're talking about fitting these things in separate from your 1-hour workout, which we're fans of.
And you also work with elite warfighters who have all of the gadgets and gizmos, even a lot of the secret coolest ones, I'm sure. And as I understand, they prescribe walking. So talk about no equipment. And maybe you can talk about the importance of that for building sleep pressure as well and just overall lifestyle. Because a lot of people, as you've explained many times, do not put in the work when it comes to just simple walking.
We should be thinking about, you know, the fact that no behavior or no aspect of your body works in isolation, right? And so if you pin us down and you're like, Juliet and Kelly, what's the most important thing? We're going to go 1, 2, 3, sleep.
Sleep.
And because we're like, look, if you're stressed and you're not getting the sleep and your sleep is diminished, we can't even see what inputs and outputs are. You know, we were taken to task by the physical therapy community like 10 years ago because we were like, we have to get sleep under control if we're going to get pain and chronic and persistent pain under control. And they were like, blah, 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 sleep doesn't matter. Blah. And I was like, well, if you're going to win a world championship or go fast or grow or change body composition or learn a new skill, turns out sleep is hugely important. And of course we were right that sleep is a organizing principle. But what you brought up around with some of the work we've done with warfighters is that they found that even though they were doing intense training, when they started prescribing more steps, 12 to 15,000 steps a day, it made the warfighters, this group, specifically it was the Delta Force, those guys started to fall asleep because they were actually fatigued enough. And I think sometimes, as Juliet hinted at, we've organized ourselves conceptually around this 1 hour fitness block. I did a Peloton workout, right? I did, you know, whatever
yoga
it was.
Yoga class or whatever.
Yoga class. And that's it. I checked the box. I'm good to go. And it turns out, maybe you didn't actually burn that many calories in that CrossFit workout. You burned 230 calories. You didn't actually do that much work. So when we start to organize around these foundational principles, we see that sleep begins much earlier in the day. So for example, let me tell you a personal anecdote around my sleep and nutrition. Intermittent fasting came out and I was like, oh, this is cool. Like, let me play around with this, right? And I don't necessarily have a big drive to eat in the morning like so many other people. But what I found was I was skipping breakfast because I'm like intermittent fasting. And then I would get behind in my calories for the rest of the day.
Yeah.
And so one of the things that would happen was, hey, if I'm trying to get close to 1 gram per pound body weight of protein every day, which is a reasonable amount, and I'm trying to actually eat fruits and vegetables, I actually can't eat a huge meal and do that over and over again. So I would eat and feel full. And I'd have a snack before, and then I'd eat again. And then I would be way under caloried. My training in the afternoon sucked, right? Because I was under caloried oftentimes. I'd have a little tiny meal. And then I would eat again at like 10 o'clock. And guess what happens when you sleep on a huge belly? I would like burp and feel terrible and wake right. And get the sweats. And I was like, this intermittent fasting is awesome. I have to eat at like 11 o'clock at night to hit my macros. I'm hungry. What's going on? I'm eating a whole jar of peanut butter when I don't want to. And it just turned out that that strategy didn't work for me when I started to look at its impact on the rest. We try to cut off caffeine before noon, sometimes 1 o'clock, because we know if we just drink a bunch of caffeine, because it's so fun to drink coffee, it's going to interrupt our sleep. And so what you pointed out, hey, if I did a little rolling before I went to bed, I actually fell asleep faster. That has been our experience. You know, the research supports that. But all of a sudden, we just talked about 10 different things that ultimately impact your sleep. And I think that's the way to be thinking about this.
Well, and the other thing that I would add about walking is that it's the best way we know to get non-exercise activity. And there's so much research that has come out about how the difference between people who have a lifelong their weight is controlled for their whole life versus people who really struggle with their weight is often not that 1 hour exercise block. It's actually total movement throughout the day.
Yeah.
And you know, people who are just plain moving a lot throughout their day, in addition to formal exercise, are really just able to control their weight more because they're actually just getting enough movement in the day. And you know, we're such evangelists of walking generally because it brings about that sleep pressure and 5,000 other things, but it really is this important way to rethink that, you know, again, you can't just check the box of the 1 hour workout and think you're good, you know, from a calorie control standpoint or from an overall movement standpoint.
Or decongesting your tissues.
Or even, you know,
flushing your lymphatics.
Yeah, adapting to and recovering from that 1 hour training session that you did. You know, walking is one of the best ways to do that. So I think, you know, and we've really tried to, you know, encourage people to figure out small ways to add in more walking. You know, the 10,000 steps is what everyone's heard. Turns out the research shows that you get almost all the benefits of walking, you know, in terms of longevity and you know, all the other beauties of walking at about 8,000 steps, which is really an accessible number for a lot more people. I mean, you can do, you know, 10, you know, you can do 3 to 5 10-minute walks a day and a 20-minute walk, and you can really accumulate that amount of steps realistically. And so, you know, our benchmark is 8 to 12,000 steps, but it, you know, it, I think people would be shocked at how much better they feel, how they can buffer some poor food choices and sleep better if they just walk.
Cookies are not poor food choices. It's a food group.
You know, but you can buffer a little more fun in your diet if you're moving a lot, you know, and food is fun. It's supposed to be fun. You know, it's communal and fun. And we've made it less so.
It's true. But it's important to recognize that you can have a heck of a lot of fun with it, especially and maybe only if you're physically active, and that those things kind of go hand in hand. And under fueling is a huge problem as well. So you might as well have a dang good cookie from time to time. We slammed some pumpkin pie last night. It was fantastic. And it's probably going to inform my workout in the following day as well. So I just want to say,
you know,
yeah, go ahead.
Juliet did this. I was just gonna say that Juliet did this calculator when we wrote Deskbound. She found this calculator that if she just was not standing or not sitting in a classic chair, but perching, moving, fidgeting at her desk, she burned 100,000 calories a year. An additional 100,000 calories.
And Kelly was like, that's so much ice cream.
And I was like, well, I outweigh you by almost 100 pounds. I'm just going to round down 170,000 calories up for grab. Like, just imagine in your brain a pile, and I'm not even talking about walking, I'm just talking about not sitting all day long, a pile of ice cream on your kitchen table, 170,000 calories of that you just get to write off like some weird tax scheme. So, you know, the key here is that, you know, when you start to see how easy it is to integrate these essential behaviors, you come to what we think is the problem. You think you're kicking butt and you're not. You're just getting by. You actually have a lot more capacity to work harder, which is our message to the teams we work with. You think you're killing it, but you're not adapting as well. So you can't handle the volumes. And in your own life, you think you're lucid and kicking ass and you're telling yourself a lie. If you can do these things, you actually can work harder and be fresher. So Thursday or Friday rolls around, you're playing with your kids, you feel great, you're lucid, you still have energy for the weekend.
I love it. Well, I would love to have a 3 to 4 hour Joe Rogan marathon talk with you guys here today. But
you're our people for sure.
Yeah, we love that.
We covered some ground. What is the best place to find your work, your Built to Move book, and all of the rest of your books and apps and other things that you're working on?
Sure. The best place to learn more is at builttomove.com. And the book is also available at all retailers, Amazon, Barnes and Noble, you know, anywhere. It's in bookstores. It was even in the airport bookstore. We were excited to see.
That's where it should be.
And then, yeah, we were so exactly. That was our hope and vision. And you can follow us at The Ready State on Instagram. I'm at Juliet Starrett if you want sort of a family behind the scenes look at what we're doing on a day-to-day basis.
And let me add that the mastermind here has also created, as the architect behind, we created an entire companion video guide for free that goes with the book. So it's a 21-day challenge. You'll get tripped out. I think we made like 80 pieces of content for it. And it's free. So if you go to builttomove.com, you can sign up and get the book. And you can have this companion course show up every day because we know that people need support and we all kind of have different motivations. But if you're looking at helping your family, sign them up, get them the book, you'll change. That's really an incredible resource.
Right on. Kelly and Juliet, thanks so much for joining us here today. You guys rock.
Great to see you.
Thank you so much for having us.
Hey, it's Abel one last time, and I just want to say thank you for listening to this episode of Fat Burning Man. Before you go, please smash that like button, hit subscribe, or even leave us a quick review. It helps so much more than you even realize. And if you can think of someone else who you care about friend, family member, anyone else who might appreciate this free show, then please take a quick second just to share it with them. Word of mouth is really the way that we've grown this show over the years. We have more than, at this point, 4 awards in independent media, 50 million downloads. We couldn't do any of this without you, so we really appreciate it. If you'd like to get in touch with me, then please follow me under Abel James or Fat Burning Man on your social media platform of choice, and I'll do my best to get right back to you. Now, if you want to keep this show coming to you, you can do something really quickly here. My wife Allison and I, along with a very small team, depend on listeners like you to make this show happen week after week. To join our next challenge, coaching group, or get in touch with me one-on-one, visit fatburningman.com. We also make group coaching free with your subscribe and save orders from our family company, Wild Superfoods, which you can find at wildsuperfoods.com. And if you'd like, you can throw a few bucks into the tip jar as a one-time donation or become a contributing member of our group on Patreon. Just look up Abel James on Patreon and you can join in the fun for as little as a few bucks and get my international best-selling book and audiobook as a special thanks. You can also find that page at fatburningman.com/tipjar. Now, a quick disclaimer for all those legal eagles out there. The Fat Burning Man Show provides general information and discussions about health and related subjects. The information provided in this show or in any related materials are not intended and should not be construed as medical advice, nor is the information a substitute for professional medical expertise, diagnosis, or treatment. The opinions and views expressed on this show have no relation to those of any academic, hospital, health practice, or other institution, including corporate overlords. We don't have any of those. If you or any other person has a medical concern, I wholeheartedly encourage you to consult with your healthcare provider. Whew! Okay. Don't forget to join our newsletter over at fatburningman.com. When you sign up for our email, I'll even send you a wild quick start guide along with a few of our ridiculously tasty recipes, even Allison's famous chocolate cookies as a special thanks for signing up. This is Abel James signing off. Thank you so much for listening and have a great week.